Hello and welcome to Dinis Guarda, Cities ABC and Open Business Council series. We are a fast-growing YouTube and podcast thought leadership channel focused on profiling the global leading inspiring people, CEOs, authors, technologists, academics, and people that are framing and creating a new vision for our world, and especially looking at solutions how we can actually get better results for the problems that we are facing. In this channel, we've been actually highlighting ideas, products, inventions, software, books, and solutions to the multiple challenges and opportunities we face in our cities and our society. But we face especially, and we actually profile special people. People that are inspiring, people that are doing fantastic projects, and people that are trying to transform our world. With all the areas and all the challenge from fourth industrial revolution to blockchain, AI, and all the frontier technologies that are disrupting and as well accelerating our evolution as humanity. These podcast series are produced and distributed on citiesabc.com and openbusinesscouncil.org and syndicated on intelligenthq.com, fashionabc.org, edgefink.com and tradersdna.com, our associate partners and as well media platforms. Mr. Sanjay Agarwal is the chairman and CEO of Paramount Communications and is as well the president of the PhD Chamber of Commerce and Industry of India. So looking forward to talk with you, Mr. Sanjay. So I want to start firstly with a bit of an introduction about you, background, overview, and education. I know that as well that you were born in the business of your family, but as well you achieved some fantastic things from that to the different areas that you've been doing. So a bit of that background to start.
All right. You see, I was, as you mentioned, I was born into the business. My father started the enterprise in 1955. Those were the times when India was newly independent country and we had a severe shortage of resources. That was the time when there was not only a severe shortage of resources, but there was a huge crunch on the foreign exchange front, which meant that you know, a lot of things that one wanted to buy were simply not available because the foreign currency was also not available. Of course, it had to do with the socialistic policies of the then government also, to some extent. It's not very easy to, you know, make up one's mind as to whether it was a right or wrong path. Maybe it was needed at that time, or that was the flavor of the moment across nations at that time. But the net result was that there was a very huge shortage of capital, and except for some few, very few large enterprises, which mostly were government-owned, or some privately-owned large enterprises, which were there before independence for some long time. Most of the business was done by very small micro enterprises. And that is the sort of enterprise my father had started. So this this business of making cables, he started making wires for domestic electrical wiring inside the houses. It was a very small business. In terms of manpower, I think he started with some 10 or 12 workers in the factory, very small premises. But then kept growing, added, you know, the brand gained some traction and people recognized the quality of our product slowly. By the time I had done my graduation, I passed out from Sri Ram College of Commerce in Delhi in the year 1983. And then by the time I joined the business, our turnover was in the region of 10 million rupees. That was still a small business, but we were an established business. We were at that time making wires for the telecommunication department, the drop wires that were used to connect the telephone pole to your home for the telephone. So that was the time when I started my career. My father, in addition to doing his running his enterprise, he used to spend 50% of his time working for the MSME sector for the other small entrepreneurs who were less educated and for whom he would be face and to take their issues to the government departments as being an active member of various trade chambers or associations, or on the other side, advising and guiding them how to deal with the various government regulations and all, which were not easy for the small entrepreneur even today. So by that time, when I joined business, that was a time when some changes had also started taking place in the Indian economy. So that's why I thought I'll link my company, my career, and the overall economic scenario and the way India moved. Till the 70s, India was moving on a very, socialistic and conservative path, which meant that India was having that famous Hindu rate of growth of 2 to 2.5% per annum on GDP. By the 80s, realization had set in that the country needs to open up, and the first exposure to computers started. And the leadership also started talking about technological changes, and some opening up started. So what I recall is by 1983, when I joined the business, there were opportunities opening up. There were some new things to look up to, and some regulations were slowly being dismantled. So I started developing new products for our company, and some of those products which India was not able to import because of the foreign exchange shortages, but at the same time could be manufactured locally. So we developed some special signaling cables for the Indian Railways, which the comparatively larger enterprises were not seriously interested in doing. So I was able to succeed, and that set me off on that path where we started innovating and started building a name for, coming out with new products that the country needed, or the economy needed, or the customer needed, whichever way you look at it. And that is what fueled our way to growth. And from that 10 million rupees, the numbers today as a group, what we are doing is 8 billion rupees, roughly, of the turnover. So we developed new products, innovative products, which were a lot of innovation in India, considering the resources, limited resources that we had, considering the access to machinery or to even raw materials that we had. So we had to do a lot of innovation and change the designs, but reach the targeted results that were required. So I think the way my company grew, I think it is more or less a microcosm of the way the Indian economy also started growing. 80s, it started picking steam. In 1991, there was the big bang opening of the economy by the then finance minister, Manmohan Singh. And lots of industries were de-licensed, and the so-called license Raj was, at least we began to dismantle the license Raj. And then companies started, looking at bigger growth. So even we transformed from an MSME, as defined in the Indian parlance, to a medium-scale company. We came out with a public issue in mid-90s. We got listed on the stock exchange, and we were able to, invest into the machinery and the products that we wanted to. And since then, it has been a substantial growth story. My younger brother also joined me in the business in 1986. And together, we built up the business. Today, we have a very wide product range from telecommunication side, optical fiber cables that are being used all over the country, then to power cables, high voltage power cables, then specialized cables for electronics and telecommunications, and then signaling cables for railways. Railways was where I made my first initial breakthrough and, with a new product. So all these things have together made us into a strong player in the cables industry with a very wide range. And then we have developed additional strengths in related areas like submarine cables. We have developed our capabilities to to repair and install submarine cables. We got our first contract on submarine cables as an Indian company, which usually such jobs are not done by Indian companies. So the submarine cable link between India and Sri Lanka, which was lying damaged for 2 years. So we were able to get it, you know, on, get it working, and get it safely embedded in a concrete cover on the seabed so that it doesn't get damaged in the shallow sea by the anchors of ships hitting the cable. So these are all things. So we have developed various other specialist capabilities also, in addition to the cables, the wide range of cables that we have. We acquired AEI Cables, which was in fact the oldest cable company in the world. It was established in 1837. And we acquired that company in 2007. The plan was, of course, to to make it into a worldwide footprint for Paramount Cables and AEI Cables together. Unfortunately, by 2008-09, all that meltdown happened, which made things much more difficult. So thereafter, we had to ultimately, after 7 years, we decided to exit that company. But overall, cables is our forte. It's been a very rewarding journey, and we feel very proud of our innovations, of the quality of our product, and the quality of our relationship with our stakeholders, starting from our employees to our customers, to our vendors. I think that is something that we really feel happy and proud of.
Congratulations. It's an achievement. You took a small family business to become one of the biggest organizations in this area. But as well, it reflects as well the growth of the Indian economy, because your company is 60 years old, and actually the more or less the India from independent countries is a bit more, but is more or less similar. So there's a lot of things that happened during this time, like you mentioned, from a more socialistic society and an economy very controlled, to a fast-growing economy that we have right now. And there's well a lot of the infrastructure that has been growing, because India has been leapfrogging in a lot of different ways. So managing a company during all this is quite an achievement, but it's as well very difficult. And as well, it reflects and it needs a lot of capacity to adaptation, both on the culture, on the technology, and a lot of different areas. So I would like to touch, just to ask you, from your experience building this with the family business, but growing it to this stage and these achievements, what would be the biggest difficulties? I always like to look at difficulties that you've been facing, and as well, how do you cope with that to reach where you are right now? And as well, in parallel with the Indian growth of the economic, social, and as well technological, because India right now is a powerhouse in technology in a lot of different areas. This was not the same 60 years ago.
Well, see, to be honest, the difficulties that an entrepreneur would really, you know, feel bad about were those which the country faced, let's say, till the opening up in the 90s. After that, that unshackling of the economy, you know, so much opportunities came up for anybody who really wanted to grow. The difficulties then are the typical difficulties of finance, for example. You know, everybody needs capital to grow, and capital is always a scarce commodity across the world, and always too many people running for the same capital. So I think that is the typical challenge that most entrepreneurs, most businesses always have. Of course, every country has its own distinct set of issues. We had the leftovers of the license raj, which we had to grapple with many times. The bureaucratic red tape, even if you have cut through with a knife or a scissor, but still some remnants remain. And so something that you do, something gets stuck in the red tape. Now, those are the sort of challenges that as an entrepreneur one had to face and manage. But as part of the civil society also, I think one has to play a role, and I have been very active, which in fact I learned from my father. I've been very active in taking up the matters on behalf of the industry to the powers that be, whether it's the state government, central government, or whichever are the departments or whatever ministries that sometimes can cause problems or can be of help also, either way. So lots of times, that's why very strongly feel that at least in India, the chambers, the business associations have played a very strong role in, representing the business side to the government side, to be the honest broker, to bring up the issues and to try and find the solutions. So I think challenges are always there. Each business will have different challenges. If I try to recount my challenges which I face, probably they would be quite distinct from somebody else in another business. So I don't think that would be of general interest. But yes, challenges in India were also compounded by a lot of remnants of the license raj, which we are all working very hard to get over with. And I think the basic intention even in the government is to get over those, but sometimes those legacy systems, those procedures, they take a bit of doing to tackle.
Yeah, and I think this is the critical element for business nowadays, because I think you have right now being the president of PhD Chamber of Commerce, and of course there is a very critical organization in India that reflects actually one of the biggest, probably the biggest chamber of commerce in India, with 130,000 companies and a huge dynamic as well in terms of a lot of initiatives. And like you mentioned, this is the relationship that are critical for all business, because we need to work with our peers, understand,
let me,
like you
let
mentioned.
Me give you an example. Let me give you an example. When the COVID lockdown happened, in India, it was announced on 23rd of March. Now, 23rd of March, our financial year ends on 31st of March. That was a very crucial time in any case, because lots of companies are looking to, close their books by 31st March, to clear their stocks, do hundreds of things which people do at the year end. Those nobody could do anything about it. It was the assessment of the government on the risk on the health front that caused it. So fine. But let me tell you, when the lockdown happens, there are hundreds and thousands of problems which need to be sorted out, because nobody knows. It's been done for the first time. Nobody knew what's even those who passed the orders really did not know the ramifications fully. So within a week, our PhD chamber was up and running. We were able to devise the system of virtual conferences and meetings, in which we would get the relevant authorities, the relevant government departments, state governments, that central government, local city authorities, and our members on the same platform. And you'll be surprised to know what a large number of issues were sorted out across the table. Because at that point of time, even the bureaucrat forgot about the red tape. I think they were all concerned about the disaster facing us. So everybody was on the same page, and we were able to get so many issues sorted out, and so many things sorted out, in the sense that the factories were able to get working. There used to be hundreds of difficulties. If an area is sealed, how does an employee from area A go to area B? How do goods move from area A to area B? How does one get a permission for a truck to move from this place to that place? Hundreds of things. All those things, with genuine efforts and right up to the top of the government, in fact, right up to the Commerce Minister, or various ministers of different ministries were involved in our webinars, on our virtual conferences. And they would issue orders straight away that, okay, please do something about it, and the issues would get sorted out. So I think this huge disaster of COVID-19 has also opened new doors, opened new ways of thinking, which nobody ever realized that could be done. None of us thought that we would be able to function in that fashion. So simply because of this disaster, it's that all these new systems have come up. Earlier, you would need a meeting with a senior official. He would grant you an appointment after 2 weeks, maybe. And then he might be too busy. And when these times were there, one was able to get the access, get them on screen, hear the issue, and sort them out. So I think this has been a very satisfying role that our chamber has played. And I'm not saying we are alone. Others have also done a lot of work. Although I must claim with satisfaction that we took the lead and we did a huge number of such programs.
Yeah, congratulations. And I think that is key because I think, independent, like you mentioned, of all the challenge of COVID-19, if it wasn't for all these digital tools that we're using, I think things could have been much, much worse because, there's a lot of millions of people affected and there's a lot of issues. But if you look, for instance, the last big pandemic was in 1920, precisely 100 years ago, and there was 200 million people that died. So the numbers, and at the time there was not 8 billion people like we have now. So we have to look things in proportion, but as well with the opportunities that come out of this. So one of the things that I'm particularly interested to know is that, so the PhD Chamber of Commerce, it's an organization with 115 years. That's quite a wonderful number to have. And it's a fantastic achievement keeping for 115 years. So can you tell us a bit about the background and the work that was done so far on this? Because it shows all the history of India and, of course, the most modern that you just mentioned, what you're doing.
You see, our chamber started in the year 1905. It was called the Punjab Chamber of Commerce initially. And we were a British colony at that time. And as expected, there were a mix of British businessmen and Indian businessmen who launched the PhD chamber. Over the years, of course, Indians did start taking more and more interest in the chamber. And later on, the state of Punjab got bifurcated into Haryana and Delhi. So it became, Punjab and Haryana. So it became Punjab, Haryana and Delhi chamber. But over the years, we have become a pan India Chamber. We are spread across 23 states and union territories. So the few that are left, we hope to cover them very shortly. So then the PhD for us became Progress, Harmony and Development. And so we are the Progress, Harmony and Development Chamber of Commerce and Industry. And I think that fits our ethos very perfectly because we have to progress, we have to develop, but with harmony. So harmony is also crucial, and progress and development have to work with harmony. And that is what we are working on. And I think our history, if you look these 115 years, some of the, we have got the tallest leaders in our country who have participated in our events. Our prime ministers, presidents have very frequently visited our annual general meetings and some even other events also. So I think all this, what it is aimed at is all this, what it really helps to do is to give you the credibility to go and argue and to do policy advocacy on behalf of your constituents, on behalf of the trade and industry. And that is what we feel very proud about. The one thing that makes the PhD chamber very distinct from the three other large chambers in the country is that we are majorly focused on MSMEs. The other chambers do all, of course, try to look after MSMEs also, but they tend to have a larger focus towards the large enterprises, which constitute their, major leadership throughout the years. But in our case, we have had a very strong tradition of looking after and being responsible for the interests of the MSMEs.
Yeah, and SMEs are definitely the most important thing for any economy. In the end of the day, are the SMEs that create jobs and keep jobs. So can you tell us...
I'd just like to add one thing, you know. It's not just business all the time. It's also social responsibility. We have two foundations, the PSD Family Welfare Foundation and the PSD Rural Development Foundation, which do a lot of work on the social front. In the Rural Development Foundation, in addition to doing many other things like, skill development and, renovating schools on behalf of companies and all, the biggest thing that we are doing is we have built more than 300 check dams, which are providing, irrigation and water availability in very arid areas to villages. The Family Welfare Foundation takes up lots of small projects helping the poor to learn, pick up skills and all those things. But especially during the COVID, what I can tell you is we, as a chamber, our members donated 5.2 billion rupees to the Prime Minister's fund for COVID relief, PM CARES. Our members were most active in distributing relief across to people who were actually not able to access the food or services that were needed. My own company, we were distributing free food from our canteens from both our factories on the highways to people who needed food. And I think thousands of our members were actually involved, and we have a whole album of the work that our members did on this front. So I think ultimately, as a responsible member of the society, one has to play a role in whatever challenge the nation faces.
Yeah, and I think this is one of the wonderful things about India, this capacity, independent of all the different things, to capacity to have a social integration. So at the moment, as we speak, there's 40, according to some of the numbers, there's around 42 million SMEs in India, which is around a staggering 95% of the total industrial units is in the country. And they employ around 40% of the Indian workforce. So,
and 45% of the exports are by MSMEs from India.
Oh, that's impressive. So on the work you've been doing, and of course, this is a digital interview, how do you are, because you mentioned all this social impact, which is critical, and social impact nowadays come with digital impact, because the companies that have more digital capacity, they can learn more, they can even find more assistance, more mentoring, more capacity. So I know that you are very focused on that. Could you tell us some of the things you're doing on these directions?
You see, as a chamber, we take policy advocacy to be the most prime responsibility that we have to undertake for our constituents. And I think on that front, this COVID pandemic has actually opened up a totally a new way. Earlier, whenever we used to disseminate information, for example, on intellectual property. So it's policy advocacy, not one way, it's both ways. To the government and from the government or from the authorities to the businesses also. Now, for example, today, intellectual property rights, we hold workshops. Now, when we do that, whether I am hosting a workshop in Delhi or in Mumbai or in Kolkata or anywhere, it does not matter because anybody can log in. So the number of attendees to our programs which are importing, which are giving the required skill or knowledge or information to our members. Earlier, you would call for a small program and 50 people would appear in a hall and they would have tea and they would spend 2 hours coming, 2 hours going and 1 hour interacting and, sometimes satisfied, sometimes not. Whereas now what's happening is you can have 300, 400 people attending a webinar easily. And it's geography doesn't matter. As long as the subject is of interest to you, it doesn't matter whether you are in Delhi or in Amritsar or in Lucknow. It doesn't matter at all. So the sort of dissemination of information, knowledge, or even discussion, and then bringing out the issues that if whatever are there, and to take them up and to be able to suggest, practical, solutions of day-to-day issues to the government also, that has become much easier, and we are able to do it much more effectively. Earlier, our mind was not attuned to having these webinars, and now I don't think this is going back. Even if let's say COVID vaccine fully succeeds and people do end up starting meeting and everything, I still feel that a lot of activity, maybe a majority, maybe a huge majority of actual work would now keep happening on the net, on the internet, because that is the lowest cost option in terms of not just money, but even in terms of time. You have to attend a 1 hour program. You attend it from your home. So you are spending exactly 1 hour. You're not spending 2 hours going there and 2 hours coming back.
This is very impressive. And I think it can make a big difference. I've been actually doing some guest lectures in India. And of course you have a massive young population that can actually learn a lot about this. But I think one of the things that I'm on the personal level, and as well, like you mentioned, social responsibility, and that's part of my work, is I think a chamber of commerce like yours with 130,000 companies has a massive opportunity as well to create a lot of ecosystem, and the ecosystem to empower, the ecosystem to change, and the ecosystem to even create new policies for the government, like you mentioned. So are you right now on the follow-up of COVID-19 trying to really create new both streams of activities besides the education and these workshops to tackle this? Because it's a big opportunity. It's actually the biggest opportunity for business right now.
I think as a chamber, we all need to, we need to evolve like any other business or any other organization. And we are very open to new opportunities and to, see how best we can serve our members. So any good opportunity that we find, anything that we feel is going to be of advantage to our members, I think we will have a very open mind about it. And let me tell you that our secretariat, the leadership comes and goes. It's a secretariat which is the actual backbone of the chamber. And the likes of Dr. Jatinder Singh, who's interacting with you, these are the people who are the brains trust of our chamber. And they are continuously working, and our job as leadership is to encourage them and to, take their ideas forward. And, there is a large number of ideas that do come, and then they have to be, of course, filtered and then, gone forward. We have worked with the government actively on many areas, including skilling, including, intellectual property rights, training, and then education of entrepreneurs on the, various regulations and laws that come up, which are also in a flux and keep changing. So to keep our members updated and to have regular interactions and to get their issues sorted out, to work with the states when they want to attract entrepreneurs, that is one major activity we do. For example, with the state of Punjab, we do a annual fair called Pitex. Now this year, we have not been able to hold it till now. Typically, it's held in the month of, end of November or early December. If nothing else, then we'll do it virtually in February or March. But these are the places, these are the sort of events or activities which provide the opportunity for the entrepreneur to interact with the, lot of people that one would not otherwise be able to meet. So I think those same platforms now, the new development that, for example, that we are doing is, we used to have a lot of, we used to take delegations of Indian MSMEs to various foreign countries where they would exhibit their wares and they would, actually be able to sell them also. And that has also been one big activity that we have been doing. And now in today's COVID times, we have done that again on a virtual platform. So these are the sort of technical or technological, innovations that our chamber has been able to do. And to, so those members who are not able to now travel to third countries, at least with their wares, at least they are able to, you know, try and do, you know, try and do the same on a virtual platform.
No, completely. And I think this is a big thing right now, because, for instance, if let's say if I want to hire a company in India, I want to make sure that this company is certified. I want to make sure that this company is real, that the people are credible. And of course, the chambers of commerce are becoming more important than ever. So I know that the HD chamber has been authorized by the government of India to issue certificate of origin, non-preferential to Indian exporters. Can you tell us about this? Because I think this is one area that is going to be increasingly more important. Because I can use an example that I had some countries where I wanted to do business, where I had very big surprises because of some of the companies that appears a bit like James Bond things. So I think the importance of the details is really important. And as well, from now on.
Let me tell you, the certification part, we have been doing, I think maybe for the many decades, probably, you know, we have been doing the certification part. We have been considered a reliable chamber and a reliable partner by the government for many decades now. And one new thing that has happened is, again, that even this certificate of origin and export document certification that we are doing now, even that has been turned virtual now. So we are doing it now on the web. People don't have to come and physically visit our office if they don't wish to. If they wish to, they can. But they can get their certificate of origin and everything certified.
A lot of these certifications international are more important than ever. One thing is national, but international as well. For, let's say, for an investor that wants to go to India like me, or other people that want to hire people in India, I know that you do it internal, but are you trying to do as well external, just to understand?
No, we can. You see, as a chamber, if there is a possibility of working with any organization which needs that to be done as a certifying agency, for example, that okay, we can verify the you know antecedents of a business that needs to get done and all those things. I think we can look at it as an activity that we'll have to see if it is a viable activity. We can definitely be interested in doing that. It's not an issue, because yes, the advantage of our doing it would be that there is a substantial credibility involved to the exercise.
Completely, especially with international organizations. So I have the two last questions, and I appreciate your time. We've been passing 1 hour. So with COVID-19, like you mentioned, there's a massive opportunity to redesign the SME sector, and as well using digital transformation technologies to create better social impact and especially empower the founders of companies, the employees, and educate them, but as well to take them to a new level. So India is a particular, first of all, is a massive economy with the biggest population in the planet, and as well with the bigger number of companies as well per percentage. So in terms of doing business and commerce in India, for someone listening to us from outside, any suggestions that you want, especially from a chamber of commerce, that you want to highlight? Because I'm particularly interested to hear your opinion, because you've been doing business there outside, but as well, you are representing a big organization.
You see, let me tell you, India is one of the most, I would say, inviting places to do business in the sense that every country will have its own peculiar set of difficulties, and I don't deny that that we in India also have some set of difficulties. But the good thing about us is that we have a stable democracy, we have a stable judiciary. Even if slow, rules of law matter in our country, and when I think commercial decisions are always a matter of trust and what sort of partner one is able to get. What sort of business one is wanting to enter, I think, and what is your own core strength and what is the core strength of your partner that you're looking at. But in principle, India is the right place to do business today because of nothing else but our huge, huge market. We are going to be the third largest economy in maximum 5 years, 7 years, but even today, in terms of purchasing power parity, we are only the third largest economy in the world. The size of the market by itself tells you that this is the place to be. You know, if you want China plus one, for example, although after a stage, I don't know the way the new bamboo curtain is coming up. I don't know the way the world fault lines will develop. But I think at least from India, one can be very sure of one thing, that is stability. And, trust that one can have that your technology is not going to be stolen, your IPR is not going to be stolen, and that you might not be disenfranchised of your business any day. Now, that sort of stability, that sort of strength that India has with the size of the marketplace, the sort of vigor that our business has, they're all raring to go, and there's too much to be done. So people are really anxious to get on with it. So I think it's an ideal place to do business, to base a business for catering to the world. Yes, difficulties are there, but they are being handled, being sorted out. And if everything is sorted out, it becomes the ideal utopian place, then there's no more money to be made, you know, practically, right. You know, you have to enter at the right time. So this is a time when things are going to happen, and they have reached a crucial stage. So my belief is that with the sort of opportunities that have now opened up, again, COVID is a disaster. The whole world has suffered. India has suffered very badly. But it has shown two things. You cannot depend on one source, which the whole world was, even India was depending on for so many things for China. And China had COVID, nothing else. Just one disaster meant that so many of our industries, such a large slice of our economic sector was totally in trouble because China was not producing or not dispatching. That was for 2-3 months. And then thereafter, COVID came with its own set of difficulties. And then, of course, came the troubles, the trade troubles. But all said and done, it tells us that India is the ideal alternative, if not for 100%, but at least for maybe 50% of what one wants to do.
I'm a huge passionate about India, and I believe that definitely is going to be shining in the bright future. And I think with this present challenge, are going to be just an opportunity. I don't know if there's any final words you want just to highlight about the Chamber of Commerce, any initiatives you want to highlight. I think it's important for people listening to us. We have a global audience. And as well, probably my last final touch or question is, how do you see this future of India? Because you touch about the present and the different things, but because I think, of course, everyone is looking at India as the new global powerhouse, because of course he has the population, he has the market, but he has as well a huge technology. If you look at the CEOs of major companies right now are Indian, from Microsoft to Google, just to name a few. So you hear last words.
You see, I think, if you look at it, you know, it's not just our population. It's not just the technical prowess that, of course, we are still in the process of developing, but we have reached quite a good stage. But then on top of that, you know, the demographic dividend that this country is poised to have for the next 20 years, that is the most solid guarantee of an economy that has to go up and up. And that is the, you know, icing to the cake, the demographic dividend, in addition to our size of the economy, in addition to whatever other advantages that one might discuss. I think as a country, we have a long way to go. We have to contribute in many, many ways to the world, economically, socially, and, ecologically. I think the sort of initiatives that India has taken despite being much, much poorer compared to our very, 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 very rich Western cousins. The sort of money that we have invested in solar power, for example, to reduce the pollution or the environmental impact of power generation. So all these things, the way we are going, the way we are working, I'm very, very hopeful that as a nation, we have to do very well. There is no two ways about it. But then at the same time, we have to be a positive force in the world. That is my biggest confidence, that India is going to be a positive and constructive force in the world. Not just fighting its petty battles. India probably has not been doing that even ever in the past. There might be political differences. There might be differences on policies, many policies. But as a nation, we have always had been very positive contributor to the world and never been the aggressor in any circumstance. So I think that is something that India is going to offer to the world as a strong economic power with a positivity and not a threatening stick.
Well, that's a wonderful way to wrap up this interview. So I'm thankful and grateful for all this time and as well fantastic insights and inspiring, and especially these last notes are key, and this shows as well your vision and as well the vision that I think India and as well has to offer to the world. I want to thank you. It's been a huge honor and a privilege as well to be here with you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.